Okay, everyone, why don't we get started? Hi, everyone. I'm Laura Sparks, president of the Cooper Union, and I want to thank you all for joining us. I'm really honored to welcome you today as we come together in celebration and remembrance of our friend, Margaret Morton. It really brings me such joy to see your faces, those of Margaret's students and colleagues especially, and to really think about the profound influence that she's had on so many of us throughout her work and her teaching. If you knew Margaret, then you also know how much she meant to our community, and in turn, how deeply she cared about Cooper. She was, above all, passionately and unwaveringly committed to supporting others, and in true Cooper spirit, to empowering others to give back. Margaret's life and work were both extraordinary. She taught design and photography in the School of Art for 4 decades before retiring just last year. And in that time, she really inspired and transformed the lives of countless students with her remarkable talent, her insight, her patience, her generosity, and her kindness. I had the privilege of getting to know Margaret over the last few years and quickly came to see why she was such a beloved and respected part of the Cooper family. She had this warm, inviting, unimposing disposition, but also just a core of steel. There was no messing with Margaret, and it's really hard to embody both of those things. And to my mind, those are also qualities that really helped to make her such a sensitive and skilled photographer. As a social documentarian, she challenged people to see humanity where it's often unjustly overlooked. In that respect, Margaret exemplified so much of what Cooper is all about in her creative spirit and her lifelong passion for education. But also in the profound sense of care that she had adopted for her city of New York and for her fellow human beings. Her photography is deeply moving, not only because of the lives and experiences that it chronicles, but also because of the unyielding passion and compassion of the person behind the camera. We've prepared a very special tribute exploring Margaret's work that we'll share in just a moment. But first, it's my pleasure to introduce Mike Essel, Dean of the School of Art at the Cooper Union and a 1996 alumnus who has worked closely with Margaret over the years. Mike's going to offer a few words about Margaret's far-reaching teaching and her enduring influence as an educator. My sincere thanks again to all of you for joining. I'll hand it over to Mike.
Thank you, Laura. Everybody can hear me okay? Yeah, okay. Hi, like Laura said, I'm Mike. I'm the Dean of the Cooper Union School of Art. I'd just like to thank you for being here today to celebrate Margaret's life with us. In a moment, I'm going to say a few words about my friend Margaret, but after my remarks, we're going to share a link to a video. We'll all watch that video together, and when the video ends, we'll come back here to Zoom to talk and share a few words. Margaret was my first professor in graphic design. She was patient and nurturing and meticulous in her critiques, and I was very lucky. She kept in touch after I graduated, and later she invited me back as a critic and to teach 2DD. She supported me when I applied full time, supported the lawsuit to keep Cooper Union free, and supported me when I became the dean. I owe a lot to Margaret, and in fact, I'm here today as dean because of Margaret's support. I don't think I'd be back at Cooper Union without that initial invite. Man, I miss Margaret. I also know that I'm not the only person she helped this way. I've heard incredible stories of Margaret's support from many of my fellow alumni. Margaret and I were colleagues for over a decade, and above all else, I can tell you she cared deeply for her students. Every year, she invited me for a private tour of her Art of the Book show. She knew the story of each book and every student in her class. Her memory for her students was remarkable. Margaret was kind and respectful in her every action, and this came through in her photographs. About Margaret's work, Ellen Lupton wrote, Every image and oral history she produces serves to honor an individual she encountered in the city's parks, vacant lots, abandoned buildings, and underground tunnels. The word honor perfectly describes for me how Margaret treated everyone. Like her students, she was an advocate for the people and community she photographed. When Margaret retired, she brought me a piece I had made for her in class in 1993. None of you will be surprised to find out it was in perfect condition, stored in an archival bag in our collection. I'm still touched that Margaret saved my piece, that she took the care to preserve it for so long, and that she thought to return the piece to me years later. I'm going to miss Margaret so much. And I'm, like Laura said, I miss her care, her thoughtfulness, and really just her presence at Cooper Union. The place is just not the same without her. So thank you all again for being here today. And thank you to Margaret for your support, your friendship, and for your care for all of us. Thank you. So next I'm going to share a link to the video we created for today. Let's all take a moment to find the chat button for Zoom. At the bottom of your Zoom window, if you move your mouse, you will see a speech bubble with the word chat. If you click that, you will see the chat window, and in the chat room, a link to the video. I'm going to add that link now. I'm going to give you all a moment to open chat. The video is about 40 minutes. We're all going to watch together, right? We're going to stay muted here on Zoom while we watch on Vimeo. And then when the video ends, please come back to Zoom and we'll open it up for remarks.
Hello, I'm Janet Ogis. Margaret, this is for you. Margaret was a gentle and unassuming person. She described herself as a fly on the wall. Her eyes and her mind were wide open. She was an observer. She saw things that other people didn't. I met Margaret when I was a grad student at Yale on a drawing retreat, and she was a young teacher. We started a conversation that started a friendship that lasted for 4 decades. At the time, she was a painter and an artist. When Margaret moved from New Haven to Alphabet City in the mid-80s, she moved into a small apartment on Tompkins Square Park. And she called one day and said, "Janet, I think I'm becoming a street photographer." Now, Tompkins Square Park was right across the street from where she was living, and it was fully occupied by people who had made their homes in the park. And they had developed these makeshift homes. She passed them every day on her way to school, and she started to take pictures of them. She was amazed by their ingenuity and curious about the people. That's where her journey as a photographer began. Now, most people during that time would have looked away, but she quietly supported and actively engaged and cared for these new friends. She was on a mission. She didn't set out to discover it. It discovered her. She was a curious, courageous, and intrepid person. She crawled in and out of abandoned subway tunnels. She slept on lawn chairs in yurts in Kyrgyzstan. Her projects took years to develop, and all of her free time. Her dedication was unparalleled. She asked me to teach graphic design 1 with her, and we team taught a class for several years. As a teacher, she recognized and nurtured her students. She saw the best in them. Through the years, we supported each other through our challenges, and we celebrated all our accomplishments together. I was so touched by all the people who reached out to help be part of this tribute and her ability to connect with others. I think back on the day that she started her journey and her mission. Look at all she accomplished. And look at all of us celebrating her life. May she live on through her work and be remembered. Thank you.
In 1990, Margaret asked me to help her curate an exhibition in the old Ubalin Center on the second floor of the Foundation Building, Bearing Witness. Bearing Witness was an exhibition of the photographs of Howard Ruffner and others who had observed and photographed in May of 1970 what was later to be called the Kent State Massacre, when National Guard troops opened fire on peaceful student protesters on their campus. Margaret was a senior undergraduate student at the time, and I believe that her experiences in May of 1970 made her understand the power of photographs and her own role as a transmitter of the vernacular. Margaret had a sensitivity about being from Ohio, which in meetings made everybody laugh. I mention this now because I think that Margaret willed herself into being a New Yorker. She had a style that was rather elegant, yet she was eccentric. She was an eccentric New Yorker. And I mean that in the best sense. As an artist, she was tenacious in getting people to cooperate with her. As a full-time faculty member, she had an exacting intelligence and a real serious work ethic. She was enormously dedicated to the Cooper Union and more specifically to the School of Art. She was a steward of the School of Art, and she was enormously dedicated to the education of her students. It takes a significant amount of time to be a good citizen within an academic setting. It requires energy and a commitment that is often daunting. Great schools don't just happen. They're built by the hard work of individuals who put the time into shaping that school into something significant. Margaret was one of the architects in the building of the School of Art into something special. During the very difficult protests surrounding the introduction of tuition, Margaret was a champion of free education. Isaac Dinesen wrote in her book, Out of Africa, "If I know a song of Africa, does Africa know a song of me?" Margaret sang many songs for the Cooper Union. I am so very happy that we're singing this song for her.
I met Margaret in 1991 when I was curator of prints and photographs at the Museum of the City of New York and acquired a small selection of her recent photographs of squatters' homes in Tompkins Square Park. Margaret and I became friends, actually comrades in arms in a way. I was studying the photographs of Jacob Riis, who created a unique record of New York's poor in the 1890s. A century later, when Margaret was photographing New York's homeless communities, critics were attacking the documentary tradition in photography that began with Riis. They questioned his motives and the motives of any photographer to represent people unlike themselves in race, class, and culture, in particular, those less fortunate than themselves. Margaret blew right past this criticism. Her work, she explained, was not political per se, but grew organically, starting with photographing the structures built in the park across the street from her apartment. After the police cleared the park in 1990, she thought she was done, but little by little, she began to learn where the park's residents had moved, and she followed them, documenting homeless communities all over the city. The project lasted more than a decade. That she was first drawn to photographing the structures built by the homeless was a reflection of her formalist training at Yale, her interest in architecture, and her natural shyness. But as the work continued and she earned the trust of those she photographed, she made portraits and conducted interviews, getting much closer to the emotional reality of their lives. This experience, in turn, changed her life. Margaret's growing confidence as a photographer and a writer are especially apparent in her four books on New York's homeless communities. Transitory Gardens, Uprooted Lives, published in 1993, is a collaboration with Diana Balmori in which Diana's text and Margaret's images play equal parts. In the tunnel in 1995, the residents of an abandoned Amtrak tunnel on the Upper West Side became Margaret's co-authors, with her explanatory text alternating with their first-person accounts. In the third book, Fragile Dwelling, in 2000, Margaret returned to the body of work from which Transitory Gardens was made, applying the methodology of the tunnel. Her exposition is combined with first-person accounts. Glasshouse, 2004, is almost cinematic in its tight focus on a group of mostly very young squatters who moved into an abandoned glass factory on East 9th Street. The book not only features portraits and interviews, but describes the activities and rules that developed within the community over the course of several years. Their eviction, when it inevitably comes, is crushing. In the late 1990s, I wrote a catalog of the photographs of Bernie Sabat's Changing New York project, and Margaret regularly asked me to teach a class on Abbott at Cooper Union. The usefulness of this exercise seemed obvious to me. Abbott's photographs are an inspiring model for young photographers in New York City. Equally obvious in retrospect was Margaret's special affinity for Abbott. Abbott, like Margaret, grew up in Ohio and moved to New York to become an artist. After living in Paris for 10 years, Abbott returned for a visit, but quickly decided to abandon Europe to photograph a much changed New York City. Like Margaret, Abbott was drawn to architectural form, but when the Depression hit, Abbott photographed not just the architecture, but the city's volcanic social changes. Abbott, too, kept at it for 10 years. When she was told that nice girls don't go to the Bowery, at the time a haven for the homeless, Abbott replied, "I'm not a nice girl. I'm a photographer. I go anywhere." Margaret, too, went anywhere to document a changing New York that she felt compelled to photograph.
Margaret Morton met Diana Balmori, the landscape architect, urban planner, and visionary, in New Haven years ago before she moved to Manhattan and the East Village. My name is Elizabeth Howard. My introduction to Margaret came through Diana Balmori. And I believe that a lens into Margaret's vision can be found in one of the paragraphs in the opening essay in Transitory Gardens, and I would like to read to you. "On one level, Transitory Gardens show us how human beings transform their environment so that it can help us sustain them. On another level, they represent a new language, a language not yet clearly heard, or one that may have been ignored because it speaks a different, even colloquial tongue. But each of these gardens contains an aesthetic element uniquely its own and represents, at its core, the individual's creative expression, the impulse that goes beyond education, economic class, age, and gender. The gardens illustrated here, made with true economy of means by persons who were deprived of the most basic necessities, seem to point to the power of the garden laid bare. To us, they seem a testimony to the essential need for a garden. Perhaps through them, we can learn again what a garden is." Margaret Morton, I miss her gentle ways, her friendship, her aesthetic vision, and her unique voice. Thank you.
My name is Angela. I met Margaret in New York City when I was living in Glasshouse, the squat there. I came to New York when I was in my early 20s, just kind of settled in the Lower East Side with some friends. I met Callie, who's also in the Glasshouse book, and she and I became good friends. She gave me a spot in the building as a guest of hers until I could create my own spot, and Toby and I were building a space together. And while we were living at Glasshouse, I did meet my husband, who I'm currently married to. He was living in Glasshouse as well. His name is Jesse, and he is not in the book. He was not one of the people who was available and willing to be photographed and interviewed. As we were living in the building, Margaret had attended a house meeting and showed us a couple of her prior books. And I immediately was intrigued by the fact that she loved photography and that was a career for her. She was very warm, very open, very willing to share, and I loved that about her. I felt very comfortable with her, and we became pretty good friends, I believe. in my opinion. I really cared about Margaret a lot. As Glasshouse ended up becoming evicted, my husband and I strayed from New York, tried to find a more stable way of life, ended up having our first child together. And years later, Margaret would keep in touch occasionally, and I think I just randomly was thinking of her and shot her an email and asked how she was doing, and she said that that inspired her to try to get the ball rolling on trying to get the Glasshouse book put out into a physical form. Over the years, as you know, my kids were growing and things were changing, our lives were changing, Margaret would just, we would talk just about every year. I get a Christmas card from her every year, and we'd have random conversations occasionally just to catch up and see how she was doing. She sent me copies of her books, and I was glad to see them all. Glasshouse was a really great way of almost reuniting with all the other inhabitants of the building, which was really cool for me, hearing their stories in a different way that I hadn't heard from them as I was living there. And some of us, you know, were very different and didn't hang out much. So it was kind of neat hearing stories of the people that I didn't know well in the building. And then 10 years later, we'd even talked about, she'd mentioned possibly doing a reunion tour and going to see all of the people again. And she even helped us keep in touch, which was really great. I love that about her. She had a great heart for what she did. In her heart, she wanted to present as a photojournalist. She wanted to present this book with the photos. However, she had a very strong desire for people to know the stories of the people in the book instead of just making their own assumptions about who we were. So it was very important for her to put our stories in there in words, which made me understand her heart in that she wanted the people to know who we were instead of just a profit from this venture. It wasn't her motive in writing the book. I love that about her, and I feel like it speaks very highly of her character and profoundly of just who she is as a human being, in that she wants people to know from the hearts of the people who are in those stories who they are and not just, you know, what they are. So it's really great to me. And she was a wonderful human being, and I cared very much for her.
What I learned most from Margaret as a student was her consideration of the information being designed, of the subjects she was photographing, and also for the students themselves.
The best thing Margaret taught me is that you can be an absolute expert in your field while choosing to be kind and generous. I'll miss her.
Margaret Morton taught me how to teach. She taught me how to inspire younger minds, how to encourage people, how to create unbelievable 2D artwork, how to really be an artist.
The best thing I learned from Margaret was the importance of caring and creativity. Caring about the work that you do, the audience that you design for, the way in which you present your ideas, and the people that you work with.
Hi, I'm Christine Duritzel. I was from the class of 2000. I worked with Margaret Morton for 4 years, where I was her intern. And during that time, I worked on Fragile Dwelling as well as The Glass House. She was really an inspiration to me the entire time I was at Cooper Union. And what I really remember most is her ability to combine her passion for photography and art with her need to support people and help people. And I've really taken that with me in my own career and aspired to match that, and always will.
Margaret was a soft-spoken person, and her words are very precise. And she didn't need many words because of the way in which her actions spoke for her. I think she had an amazing eye, and in this way, with her words and the way she saw things, she was able to speak to the heart of things and to speak to the heart of her students and really bring out the best in them. So for that, I am very grateful for having known Margaret.
John Maeda once attributed the trajectory of his success to one teacher who cared enough to nurture the potential he didn't see in himself. Margaret was one of those pivotal teachers for me. Thank you, Margaret, for helping me navigate college through your intellectual probing and generosity and spirit. I'll miss you.
There have not been any year since 1994 that I have not been at the Cooper Union in some fashion or another, either as a student or as a teacher. And I attribute that 1,000% to Margaret Morton. Always supportive, always encouraging, and always challenging me and her other students to step out of our comfort zones and always learn and always help others to learn. These were the biggest things that I adored about Margaret, and I will miss dearly. I think the Cooper Union is going to miss Margaret dearly.
My name is Maria Prado, better known as Rhea. I was a resident in the tunnel on 103rd Street, Riverside Drive. I want to say, Margaret, you gave me so much. You gave so much to me. You inspired me. You gave me confidence. You confided in me. You were a friend to me. When you met me, I was a drug-addicted, homeless female who was pregnant at the time. I lived underground, me and a few other residents. Living was quite difficult, but after meeting you and, you know, doing the book and re-engaging with you and getting my life back on track, with your confidence and your support and your love and kindness and friendship, I was able to move forward and actually get some of the things that we had talked about, my book, my business. These things I still move forward with, the influence that you gave me and the confidence to continue to strive on. Margaret, I'm going to continue my life, and with you in mind always. You've always been a good friend to me. I will never forget all of what you have done for me. I'm so grateful for your support, your love, and your friendship. Family, friends, she is indeed a great loss, and I want to extend my condolences to you. I thank you.
My name is Viviana Tkach, and I'm the artistic director of Yara Arts Group, resident company at La Mama Theater in the East Village. I met Margaret in the mid-90s. She took part in a couple of our shows at the Ukrainian Institute and other galleries that I'm connected with also. In 2005, we went to the mines of Donetsk together, which is Eastern Ukraine where the war is now. And after that, I thought, oh, we should do another trip, but maybe an easier place. And in 2006, Margaret went with me to Kyrgyzstan, into the Tian Shan Mountains, where the story of this epic that I was working on took place. And we photographed the people and their life in the mountains. And then also these photographs became part of the show. They were projected during the show. And she also then came back the following year and took pictures in Kyrgyzstan of the show and then at La Mama. And these photographs were exhibited at the National Art Museum in Bishkek. And we put together a catalog for this. And Margaret then went on to do her book on the cemeteries of Kyrgyzstan. And several of the people who worked with me accompanied her as translators and cultural advisors, et cetera. But I did not go on those trips because I was working on another Kyrgyz epic at that point, which Margaret also shot, and we have beautiful photographs from that. And the last project I did with Margaret was this fall. Some of the photographs in this video were part of a project we called Nourishment, and it was part of the first feminist art exhibit in Kyrgyzstan. And it created a huge scandal because it was called the Feminal Nale of Kyrgyzstan. The situation that was the strangest in Kyrgyzstan was actually, there's a picture of the man pointing, and it happened about 10 minutes after that. He had taken us into the High Tian Shans, and it's on the Chinese-Kyrgyz border. And we were right there constantly And suddenly, obviously, we had really crossed over into no man's land. We didn't know. He didn't know, I don't think. We were just in a Jeep driving. And the border guards pulled up. And, you know, Americans aren't allowed to cross that border. And there, you have to go through these official places and have visas. We had nothing, you know. And she just sat with me in the back. We didn't say anything. We had our heads down. And at one point, she bent down and pulled up. We had a bottle of juice. And these kids, I mean, they're young guys, 18 years old. Who knows when was the last time they had a meal kind of deal. And we just kind of passed the bottle of juice forward. And they let us go then. So that was Margaret to the rescue situation.
On behalf of the Architectural League, it's an honor to join in the celebration of Margaret's remarkable life and work. The League and our online publication, Urban Omnibus, collaborated with Margaret to publish and exhibit her evocative images of the abandoned administrative infrastructure hidden within the monumental James A. Farley Post Office located on 9th Avenue, directly across from Pennsylvania Station. The League first worked with Margaret when serving as her fiscal sponsor for a NISCA grant that, in part, supported the publication of Cities of the Dead, her extraordinary study of the architecturally distinctive ancestral cemeteries of Kyrgyzstan. So, when we received an email from her in 2016 with the subject line, an urgent query, it immediately piqued our curiosity. In that email, Margaret described how, 4 years earlier, she was offered unique access to document what was left behind in this 8-acre facility, which once employed thousands of men and women, after it was vacated prior to its conversion to the Daniel Patrick Moynihan Station. A friend who knew that she would be fascinated with the building had put Margaret in touch with an architect working on site for the transition team. Not surprisingly, given Margaret's engaging personality, they hit it off, and she was given free run of the entire abandoned place, leading to what Margaret described as just the kind of project she would love, all those empty spaces. Accompanying this email was a link to at least 200 images documenting an almost unimaginable collection of abandoned spaces and objects, including an attic heaped with heroically scaled fractured stone ornaments, a veritable museum of antiquated technology, seemingly endless enfilades of empty offices, and the elegant postmaster's suite, her proposed exhibition venue. Soon thereafter, on a sweltering summer day, we trekked through the Farley's labyrinthine interior with Margaret. Her delight at sharing the experience of months of solitary exploration was evident as she enthusiastically led us through the soaring Piranesian spaces of mail sorting areas, as well as more intimate suites of offices, while pointing out the spatial and graphic details that prompted visions of legions of past postal workers' daily routines. Following a few months of negotiation with the Farley Moynihan team, powered by Margaret's tenacity, her exhibition was installed. The League, along with a few other organizations, was able to present memorable gatherings, tours, and talks. Later, the exhibition had a second showing in the League's small gallery, with a lecture by and discussion with Margaret. This past week, while revisiting Margaret's work, her writing, just as perceptive and nuanced as her imagery, revivified the experience of exploring the Farley with her. So to close, part of her description that captures the Farley's layered palimpsest of past and present, and perhaps more generally, an understanding of the transitory world Margaret revealed and shared through her work. The upper floors held the most mystery. Long hallways with missing floorboards led to colossal machines, objects of wonder from earlier eras. Obsolete technologies had been left in place throughout the building. The post-factum addition of electrical wiring was visible on the walls of most offices. Tangles of wires escaped from large metal boxes, the most remarkable, a room-sized metal frame for an antiquated telephone system. An accumulation of posters and signs that had never been discarded, and many layers of wall paint revealed by the removal of built-in bookcases and office furniture. Many decades were present and passing at the same time. Thanks.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Elizabeth O'Donnell, and it's an honor to join all of you in celebrating Margaret and in mourning our loss of her. While Margaret and I came to Cooper at almost the same time, we would not become friends for 20 some years. But I would come to know of Margaret much earlier through my encounters with her work. When Transitory Gardens and the Tunnel were first published, I was working as an architect and trying to find a way into a mode of practice that was also still of the discipline, trying to keep the ideas, poetics, and formal speculations of studying architecture that we would set apart from the broader social urgencies and profession of making architecture. But in her work, Margaret was already demonstrating the fallacy of that distinction, developing and mastering a practice as both an artist and an activist, making work of a deep, almost radical humanity, while fully exploring the formal principles and ambitions of her art and discipline. Each photograph freely revealed its artistry while reflecting Margaret's extraordinary empathy for its subjects and their work, the homes they built, framed against a city that would not see them. It was work that was deeply compelling, especially for a young architect. 10 years later, I was back at the School of Architecture as Associate Dean, and I finally began to get to know Margaret as Margaret. It was at one of our frequent and unplanned chats in the foundation building lobby, this time on a quiet late summer afternoon, that Margaret first told me about her journeys to Kyrgyzstan and the ancestral burial grounds of the Kyrgyz people that she had begun to photograph. She spoke of grueling travel off-road for hours in the back of a Jeep without shock absorbers, deep into the mountains of Kyrgyzstan to capture these remote constructions that seemed to defy both time and scale. I found Margaret's vision of these constructions breathtaking, a kind of architecture more of the landscape than of any social order, existing simultaneously as built form and a shimmering illusion, ghostly, but nonetheless inhabited. I invited her to show the works in the Houghton Gallery, and together we planned and selected the works for the exhibition. What a pleasure it was to work with Margaret and to finally get to know her. Margaret was both the most fastidiously careful and wildly intrepid person I have ever met. She was interested in almost anything, in everything. Joining me for a field trip to the Sunset Park Materials Recovery Facility, where all the city's curbside recycling is sent, and where her unassuming presence upstaged even the architect leading the tour, or in sharing live music as diverse as that of the Mughal dynasty and the New Sounds vocal group, Room Full of Teeth. She was indefatigably devoted to her work and her teaching and great company. So young in all the best ways, and so generous of her spirit, with an eye for seeing what was there, what was true, speaking it through her advocacy and her art. I will miss talking with her deeply, but even more miss her being with us somewhere at work on the next project.
I've known Margaret Morton for over 40 years. I think of her still in the present. I have not yet wrapped my mind around Margaret not being here. We were fellow travelers, co-conspirators, and colleagues at the Cooper Union. There are many times that we bickered, that we laughed so hard we couldn't stop, and that we told terrible jokes that even now seem a little bit embarrassing. But through all of that, Margaret was a touchstone for me. I'm sure many people will talk about her amazing artistic ability, her passion for photography, and her insatiable ferocity in documenting the people and parts of this city and this culture that people really don't want to see. And when they are confronted with it and they see it, they don't want to remember it. Margaret was able to put forward
to us and to put forward to the world images that were so beautiful and so exquisite that one did not look away. These images are a testimony to her heart and how she saw the world filtered through that heart. Yes, they're a testimony to her exquisite eye as a photographer, and yes, they're a testimony to her intellect, but most of all, they're a testimony to her heart. I'd like to read this poem for Margaret. The poet is Seamus Heaney, and the poem is Postscripts. And sometime, make the time to drive out west into County Clare along the flaggy shore in September or October, when the wind and light are working off each other so that the ocean on one side is wild with foam and glitter, and inland among stones, the surface of a slate gray lake is lit by the earth lightning of a flock of swans. Their feathers ruffed and ruffling, white on white, their fully grown headstrong looking heads tucked or cresting or busy underwater, useless to think you'll park and capture it more thoroughly. You are neither here nor there, a hurry through which is known and strange things pass, as big, soft buffetings come at the car sideways and catch the heart off guard and blow it open. Margaret blew our hearts open, and I miss her.
So now what I'd like to do is really just open it up for people to speak about Margaret. I'm going to ask, because there are so many people on this call, that in the chat, could you indicate that you'd like to say a few words, and then one at a time, I'll try to follow people in the chat and ask you to speak. Thank you.
So Mike, I just want to follow up what you said. The video is going to be embedded in the announcement page of the website where that announced this event. The video will be embedded there.
Thank you, Mauricio. Barbara Grossman, please.
Hi, thank you for calling on me. I went to Cooper Union in the 60s, so I didn't know Margaret that way. I met her in the 80s on a critique group, panel in the architecture school at Yale, which was kind of surprising since I'm a painter, and at that time Margaret was really drawing mostly. But we kept in touch, and when I was at the University of Pennsylvania, I got to invite her to speak at a forum about her work and so on. But she told me, I picked her up at the train station, and we had just had that storm, the name of which I cannot remember, and all the temporary housing on the FDR and under the Williamsburg Bridge and so on were destroyed by a flood. And Margaret had spent a lot of time there photographing the people who built those houses and lived there. And being the responsible and feeling person that you've all described multiple times, she went around to these people and said, "Is there anything I can do to help you?" And, you know, they had nothing. And so they lost almost nothing, you know, they had nothing left. And she said, no. And the people were very thoughtful as well, actually. And they said, "Well, you know, you took pictures of my house and me, and I had it up in my dwelling. Would it be possible for you to give me another photograph?" And that's all they ask of her, to be reminded of their former home and her caring about them. And I've always been very touched by that. And I don't believe she went around bragging that was how her relationship with these people was, that it was a really felt and genuine one. And I have not been in touch with Margaret for quite a few years. So it came as a bit of a bolt that she is no longer with us, but
Thank you, Margaret.
A profound effect.
Thank you. Next we have Michael Finland. You still there?
There we go, sorry, I was muted. Okay. I just want to really thank, on behalf of the Willis family, her sister Judy, the cousins in my side of the family, how great this little tribute was. You folks did a wonderful job. I know you all cared for Margaret an awful lot. And now I'm going to get broken up because I miss her dearly.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you.
Anybody else like to say a few words?
I'd like to say something. I just want to say, you know, just how foundational Margaret was to my education and also to my understanding of the Cooper Union. She taught with her actions and just her demeanor. Overall, she carried this kind of monastic character to her discipline. And just the way she saw things and how she shared them. She also is the author of a dream come true for me, which was teaching at Cooper Union. I'll tell you the story of how this came about, but I ran into her in the hallway, and I just, for some reason, my heart started racing. And I, you know, went to lunch, came back, and I saw her again in the hallway. And then I realized why my heart was racing is because I really wanted to ask her, how do I get started teaching in college? And I asked her that, would you just mentor me on how to get going? And she said, "Oh, Mauricio, it's a good thing you asked me this because I'm taking sabbatical." And you know, 30 minutes later, she had sent an email to you, Mike, so that I would teach her class for a semester. So thanks to her, I consider that as one of my biggest accomplishments. But because of her, and it's not just with me, she actually used to share all of her students' work to every class. She would bring her alumni, former students, to show their projects to every class. So in that way, she was able to connect different generations of her students together and help them in that way. So thank you so much, Margaret, for everything you've done for us.
Toby, you'd like to say a few words?
Yeah, I used to teach engineering at Cooper, and I was on the Fulbright and Menschel committees for a long time, and those were some of the most collegiate times I spent at Cooper Union with Margaret, people like Graham Shane, Peter Buckley, and every now and then I'd go into her class. She worked with my students. She was a wonderful person.
Thank you, Toby. Denise, I believe, is next.
It's Dennis.
I apologize.
No, that's fine. My mother was Diana Balmori, and she and Margaret wrote Transitory Gardens together. And they were very, very close. They were both extremely visual, that spent a lot of time commenting on things that they saw to each other. And it feels very strange to me that she isn't here to say something. She died a couple years ago. That's all.
Thank you. Rhea, would like to say?
Hi, yes. Hi, my name is Maria, AKA Rhea. I was one of the interviews in her book. I just want to say thank you for allowing me to be part of such a wonderful memorial for her. She has been more than a friend to me. She was like a family member to me. She's came to a few of my functions. We had cookouts, and she's always had a terrific heart. She's always interested in knowing what's going on, what are plans, you know. She was just so full of life. She has become a dear friend to me and my family, and I will miss her dearly. Whatever function that you're having moving forward, please reach out to me if there's anything that I can do to keep Margaret's memory alive. Please reach out to me. I'll be more than willing to do it. I thank you. My condolences to the friends and family, and thank you so much.
Thank you. Andrea Robbins would like to speak now. Thank you, Rhea.
Hi, can you hear me? Okay, good. It's nice to see everyone, and I just wanted to mention that my husband Max and I were students when Margaret came to Cooper Union, and later we taught at the same, she was a colleague, we taught with her, and we also do photo, and we also work with, we're very privileged to work with a lot of different kinds of people. And so I can really, I think, even though we never discussed it, I think there was a real affinity between us. And I was always overwhelmed by her warmth. And I just wanted to tell a little bit of a very short story. And that is that we met and we ate a number of times, but the last time I saw Margaret, I was at a movie with my son, and someone was talking behind us and talking and talking and talking. And finally, I just said, are you going to talk through this? And when are you going to stop talking? And then Margaret said, a voice from behind said, Andrea, is that you? And the reason I'm mentioning this is because there was nothing defensive about Margaret Morton. She was just, can you imagine like the back of someone's head telling her to shut up basically in a movie theater? And she was just like, well, hello there. And, you know, and after the movie, we got together and of course she was warm, but you know, at a moment when someone yells at you like that, not that I would yell at her, but I was just like, is this ever going to stop? She didn't, you know, she didn't get her back up. And I can imagine, just because I'm also a photographer, that she was in a lot of very tough situations. And that lack of defensiveness and that warmth is can be viewed as a kind of vulnerability, but I really think that that was her strength. And so I really enjoyed everything everyone said, especially Rhea, hearing about what it was like to be one of the subjects of Margaret's, because obviously it was more than being a subject. It was a dear friendship that was, I can assure you, was important to Margaret as well. And anyhow, that's all I wanted to say. Thank you all again.
Thank you. Brian, you're next.
So I met Margaret sometime in the very early 1990s. I was working at the Voyager Company and we did a summer boot camp, we called it, with NYU. And we invited Margaret to make a CD-ROM of the work she had been doing in the tunnels. And subsequently, we developed a website for that, for the tunnels. Which I think maybe is still up someplace, probably not working so well, but it's up there somewhere. And so we became very dear and close friends. And when Verlana called me and asked me if I had heard that Margaret had passed away, I almost collapsed. she shared our cell phone contract with my wife Barbara and I, so we were always in touch for one thing or another. What I wanted to say that everybody has touched on is that Margaret invested everybody she met and everybody she photographed with a sense of dignity. Even when she was criticizing you or arguing with you, you had the sense that she respected you and had invested you with the dignity of your own humanity. And I think it's the lesson that I take from Margaret most profoundly of how to relate to other people on this planet, whether we agree with them or not. And she was unique in that sense. I've never met anybody that did that in such a genuine way. It was just her, you know? And with those flashing eyes and that iridescent smile. The other thing that I'm reminded of is that saying that what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. And Margaret was had a backbone of steel, but she was a very fragile person. And she loved Cooper profoundly, but Cooper almost killed her because of the poisons in the atmosphere and the air in Cooper, because it was an art school and there were a lot of chemicals. And Margaret struggled with this over the years. And I think maybe eventually found a way to deal with it, but it never stopped her. And it never stopped her caring for the school. And I think, you know, even though she was fragile, she went into the most, you know, what we would consider inhospitable places. And in that sense, I think was quite willing to sacrifice herself for her work, but mostly for the people that she knew and loved and met. So that's all I can say.
Thank you. Mindy let me know that Verl Andrick had her hand up.
Yeah, I'm Verl Andrick.
Oh, hi.
Hi. I actually have known Margaret for 57 years. She and I went to high school together. We sang in choir. We also sang in two groups, the Melody Men and Melodettes. And after we graduated, she went on to Kent State University. I went to Hiram College down the road. So I was aware that she was very active at Kent State. Years later, it just so happened between reunions of high school that she had come to New York City in 1979-80 81, and I had come to New York in 1980. So we started hanging out together here in New York City together. We went to the Simon and Garfunkel concert together in Central Park. She came over to my apartment to all the Christmas parties here. And when she was working on the tunnel, she would come up and visit. And I said, "What are you doing, Margaret?" "Oh, I was down the tunnel." I said, "Margaret, why would you be in the tunnel down there by yourself? Don't you think that that's not safe?" She said, "Oh, I'm not worried about it. No, no, everyone's nice. They treat me right." She was fearless. She would tell me every project that she was involved in. And I thought, how did you do that? Why would you go to Kyrgyzstan? Don't you know what kind of things can happen to you over in a foreign country like that? It did not faze her a bit. She just seemed to be a person who could be anywhere and just acclimate herself. She was never condescending, but she had opinions. She was never rude, but she would share what she thought. And she always amazed me that when we got together, she wasn't a cook, by the way. She ate out a lot. So you never went to her house to have meals. She would invite me over to the top of Cooper Union for the fireworks on the 4th of July. We would go to different shows that she put together, and then we'd go out to eat afterwards. And of course, I got all her books. But you should know that our group of high school friends remained friends for all these years. And on the day after Christmas, we all met together and had Christmas together. We'd sometimes go over to her sister's house and have the cookies that Margaret helped her, Judy Orsine, to make. And this went on for many years. I even took her to Ohio in our car back and forth. But she was always the greatest friend. She was generous with her books, generous with her art, generous with the people that she was with. Back in the 1980s, just a flashback, I was with the New York City Coalition Against Hunger. I'm an actor, I've been on Broadway, and I worked in films. But we went together to see the architecture for the homeless that was at Cooper Union, that she and her husband, Tom Morton at the time, who also went to Coggle Falls High School with us, we were involved with that. I said, "Margaret, this is fantastic. You're doing all this work with the homeless and architecture for the homeless, and I'm doing the New York City Coalition Against Hunger." We had so much in common, singing, acting. And one last thing is kind of funny. I worked on a film, Ice Storm, with Ang Lee. And so I took Margaret to the party that we had. It was the final party for the Hall of the Cast. And we had Chinese food down in Chinatown, a 10-course meal. And we just sat there and she said, "This is lovely, I love this." Of course, Margaret didn't cook, so everything was fabulous on the other side of things. So I would tell you that it's been a marvel to be with Margaret all these years, and on behalf of all her friends who loved her, you would never know how sweet and generous Margaret was until you had a long, long-term friendship with her to know how special and how creative. You had never known back in high school that she would be doing what she did and that she would be fearless and still complete. It was a wonderful, thank you for the tribute to her. On behalf of all her friends, I say thank you, thank you.
Thank you, Viral. Thank you so much. I wanna be sensitive to the time. We're about at the hour mark. If anybody else would like to say a few words, please do. Okay.
Mike, I'll say a few words if that's okay. It's Lucy Lario.
Hi, Lucy.
And hi to everybody. If I don't know you from Cooper Union, I know you from Margaret's mailing lists, which I worked on extensively in the time that I assisted her at Cooper Union. So for example, Marin Stange, I taught your husband computers when Margaret sent me over to your house in 1995. She was always setting up unique meetings and opportunities for me, often telling me that I had to go to these places and do things, but I pretty much did anything that Margaret asked. And so that was just one of many errands and favors that I did. So it's really nice to finally see some faces with names after seeing them on mailing lists for so many years. As most people know, I assisted Margaret for the 4 years that I was at Cooper Union, but the biggest project we worked on together was the tunnel in the summer of 1995. So I knew her, for lack of a better word, intimately, but appropriately, in an appropriate way. And I knew the things she liked and didn't like, and I knew her sensitivities and all of those things. And she really was, what everyone is saying here tonight, a really remarkable, unassuming, gentle person. She had a rigorous work ethic, and but she never suffered from being kind. She helped me in numerous ways. For all the work that I did for her, there was a balance. She was always helping me and giving back, and she was a huge part of my life. She certainly was a huge part of my Cooper Union experience, and I can't really separate Margaret from my education in any way, because I learned as much from her in the classroom as outside of it. So thank you, Mike and Janet and John and everybody else who organized this tribute, and it was really lovely to see, and thank you for including me.
Thank you, Lucy. Maybe time for one more? Anybody?
I'll say something.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Jody Geiger. I'm her niece. And first of all, I just want to say what an overwhelming tribute this has been to see, and everybody's contributions. Janet has just worked tirelessly with our family, and I just owe you so much. Thank you, Janet, for doing that. Thank you, Mike and Laura, for helping coordinate this. It's been really tremendous to hear everyone's impact by her, and looking at almost 170 people here this evening on a Sunday evening just means so much to me and the family. You know, like Burl said, you know, she'd always come home at Christmas. So I know our hardest days are yet to come, but it's just been a really hard summer. And I can speak on behalf of my mom that she's just been under so much trying to untangle all this. And so thanks, Mom, for all that you've done to kind of help unpackage all these things for Aunt Marty. I know she's looking over at us. And saying thank you to all of you. So thank you for everyone for coming together on Sunday evening and sharing your lovely stories. And it was so wonderful to hear from everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks to everyone who came tonight. Thank you to everybody who participated in the video, and thank you to the team at Cooper Union who made this all possible. I'm so happy we could all come together tonight to celebrate Margaret's life. I think it means a lot to me, and I know it means a lot to all of you. So thank you so much. I want to remind everybody that we will share a video of tonight, and we will also get in touch with you when we have more information about the exhibition we're planning. And the only thing I want to leave you with is go out and be kind, because that is what Margaret would do. Thank you all. Everybody have a good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Janet. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Bonnie, and all the other people that have worked hard to put this together.
Thank you.
We'll be there for the rest of the
day. Thank you to all of you that did this tribute. It's really wonderful. I mean, I know so many of you knew her well. I only got to visit my cousin a few times while she was in New York City, and I wish I had known she didn't cook. I always wondered why every time I saw her, it was, well, let's go out to dinner. Well, I was traveling on business, so it was like, I don't want to go out. You know, if I had known she didn't cook, I'd have gone to her place, to her apartment, and cooked for her. But anyhow, but no, thank you. This was really, really wonderful. There was some fantastic photos in that. Great images. I love the one of the Willis family years ago, back, it would have been about the late 1950s of the up at the farm, our grandparents' farm. So just, you know, you guys did a fantastic job on this tribute. I know her sister Judy and the daughters and cousins and that all will appreciate this. Thank you.
Thank you.